Okay, I start the recording. Tekin Hocam, the stage is yours. Thank you so much.
Well, okay, thank you. Good morning, everybody. This is my fourth lecture. Now we have come to spinors on space-time, and I'm going to discuss the Dirac operator or the Dirac equation in four-dimensional space-time. That was the main topic for our discussion. The previous three lectures were a kind of a preparation for this lecture. I think it will be better if you had read the lecture notes that I had sent you on Minkowski spacetime, the spinor, forms, the Klein-Gordon equation, the Clifford algebras, and the spin group definition, because I'm going to use them a lot in this discussion. Now, first, I want to give you a derivation of the Dirac equation. That was presented by Dirac in his original paper, 1928. And this is the application of this Schrödinger prescription for getting a relativistic wave equation. So our starting point will be now the relativistic energy expression, but with the square root expression. Remember that in order to derive the Klein-Gordon equation, we have used the Schrödinger prescription for replacing E with the time translation operator and P with the space translation operator for the square of the energy expression. And then we have obtained a second order wave equation satisfied by a scalar field. However, we have also pointed out that Klein-Gordon equation in the quantum mechanical sense is problematic because then probabilistic interpretation of a scalar wave function cannot be maintained because the energy density obtained from the scalar field is not positive definite. Now, having seen these problems, Dirac suggested that in order to get a relativistic wave equation, why stick with the second order wave equation? The Schrödinger equation is obviously not a relativistic equation because the time derivatives are occurring linearly, whereas the space derivatives occur in a quadratic way. So you cannot maintain the relativity if there is such an imbalance occurring. So instead of having both of them occurring at the second order level, why don't you get a wave equation where the time derivatives and the space derivatives both appear at the first order? So in order to deal with taking the square root in the operator sense, Dirac proposed that let us write as a E, the total energy of a relativistic mass, linearly in P momentum and its mass, rest mass. Here he introduced four numbers. Alpha, when I put an arrow in it, it means that it's a triplet of numbers, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and a number beta, such that when you square both sides, you should get the relativistic energy expression squared. Let us take the square formula on the left-hand side. You need something like alpha square, and there are cross terms alpha beta, and there is a term beta square. The conditions, the algebraic conditions that should be satisfied by these four objects, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and beta, to get the relativistic energy expression that occurs on the right hand side, are these. These relations must be satisfied by these four numbers, whatever they are. Alpha I, alpha j plus alpha j, alpha I should be twice the Kronecker delta. It means that alpha 1 square should be 1, alpha 2 square should be 1, alpha 3 square should be 1, and alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 should mutually anti-commute among themselves. And beta and all the alphas should anti-commute among themselves, and beta square should be 1. Now it's obvious that ordinary real numbers or ordinary complex numbers cannot satisfy these relations because they are commutative, whereas we are talking about anti-commutative objects here. Dirac observed that he can realize these identities if he chooses for beta and alpha the 4x4 block matrices given as such. I have written beta is a 4x4 matrix, but I have written them as a 2x2 block form. I capital I is just the 2x2 identity. And then these sigmas that appear off diagonal as a block 2x2 matrix are nothing but the usual Pauli spin matrices, alpha, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. They are Hermitian and they square to identity matrix. Now, what he has done is he now takes these numbers, well, supernumerary numbers, alphas and betas, that occur in the relativistic energy expression, and then he applied the usual Schrödinger prescription. So he replaced E by IH bar times D by DT of a wave function, psi. And then here, C alpha dotted into H bar over times the gradient operator. And this is just the identity, 4x4 identity, not the 4x4 identity, it's the beta that we have written here. It's not identity, it's this traceless matrix. So he postulated a relativistic wave equation satisfied by a complex valued wave function psi. On the left hand side, I have the time derivative. On the right hand side, I have the gradients and the rest mass occurring. Now I can reorganize this equation a little bit. I have written it in terms of Cartesian, in a observer, Cartesian observer coordinate system, CT, X, Y, Z. So let me just emphasize that the Cartesian coordinates occur in this equation. So on the left-hand side, I divide everywhere by H bar. And then I multiply with beta square overall from the left. So beta goes to beta times d psi by dt. And then there is a beta alpha. It's a matrix multiplication. Beta square is the identity matrix. So nothing is done here. So I multiply by beta from the left and divide by 1 over h bar over c. So on the left hand side, I have 1 I beta over c times d psi by dt. Taking this gradient turn to the left with I going up, I beta alpha dotted into gradient of psi, and then I have MC over H bar times psi. And remember that MC over H bar is the inverse Compton wavelength of this massive particle. So in units where H bar and C are set equal to one in natural system of units, this is the mass on the right-hand side. And then I have a linear differential first order equation operator acting on psi on the left hand side. Now, in order to write this in a relativistically covariant way, I introduce what I called the gamma matrices. I think I have dropped an I here. I haven't dropped an I. I put I into the definition of the gammas. So this is Dirac equation that comes, well, the derivatives can be written in terms of the vector, the coordinate vector fields, 1 over c d by dt, d by dx, d by dy, d by dz. And then I have a set of four, what I call Dirac gamma matrices, 4x4 matrices. I identified gamma 0, contravariant index, I beta. It squares to minus 1. Beta squares to 1. I beta squares to minus 1. And then I have a set of three gamma matrices, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, which are I beta, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, gamma individually squares to plus 1. Alpha square, beta square is 1. Each alpha squares to 1. However, there is an alpha which squares to minus 1. So when you take the square of gamma 1 square, for instance, you have I beta alpha 1 times I beta alpha 1. Because of the commutativity of beta and alpha, the quantity gamma 1 square squares to 1. And similarly for gamma 2, gamma 3. And you can also show that gamma mu is defined in this way. It's a set of four by four gamma matrices, Dirac gamma matrices, written as if it's a contravariant vector field. It satisfies the basic relation that they anti-commute if the indices are distinct. And then if the indices are the same, they square to either minus one for gamma zero, plus one for mu and mu, different from zero. And then if these gammas are 4x4 matrices, then it's obvious that in the Dirac equation, psi cannot be just a complex valued wave function. It has to be a four component complex spinor. So it has to be a four component column matrix in this sense, and each component should be a complex valued function. So a Dirac spinor is in fact, it's not a simple complex valued function, it's not a scalar wave function. It is just a set of four complex wave functions that satisfies this linear differential equation. Now, what's important is that we have seen that we are realizing the square root of this relativistic energy expression. Well, then the same property should hold here. When you iterate the Dirac operator, you should get the Klein-Gordon equation. So what we are going to show is that each of these components of a Dirac spinor individually satisfy the Klein-Gordon equation. Well, that's easy. Take the Dirac equation and apply gamma nu del nu once again here. You can do it in two ways. You know that gamma mu del nu psi is the mass. So you pull out the mass and you apply with the Dirac operator once again, and that also gives you the mass term. So first way, this is m squared times psi. But on the other hand, you see that these are numerical matrices, pull it out. And then you know that the order of the partial differentiation can be changed. It's commutative. So you can write this expression as 1/2 times the anti-commutator of the gamma matrices, del mu psi. But we know that the gamma matrices satisfy 2 eta mu nu times the identity, 4/4 identity. But this 2 cancels that 1/2. And then eta mu nu acting on these derivatives gives me the Laplacian operator acting on psi. So you see that the Laplacian, the covariant Laplacian or the D'Alembertian of psi is just the mass squared times psi. So that's the Klein-Gordon equation. So if the four component spinor, complex spinor psi satisfies the Dirac equation, it's a first order relativistic wave equation, then it automatically satisfies the Klein-Gordon equation. In a sense, Dirac was able to take the square root of the Klein-Gordon operator. And it's a relativistically covariant equation. Well, in order to see that, we have to look at the Lorentz transformation properties. And a Dirac 4 spinor under a local Lorentz transformation changes by a matrix, S Lorentz transformation matrix. It's a group element. It is S is a local element of the homogeneous Lorentz group. And we know that in terms of these gamma matrices, sigma AB are the generators of the Lorentz group. So if I raise it to the exponential and lambda AB are the Lorentz transformation matrices. So a Lorentz transformation matrix that acts on a Lorentz 4 spinor is this one, e to the minus I over 2 sigma AB contracted with the Lorentz matrix. I'm not going to go into any more further discussions that, but the Dirac equation can be written in a manifestly Lorentz covariant way by introducing the spin 1-3 Lie algebra valued connection 1-4. Why do we need that? And I think this is often left without being explained. Now, the Dirac equation that I have written is specific to the Cartesian coordinate chart. Remember that here I have del mu of psi. So everything that works here is working in a Cartesian coordinate chart. For instance, if you want to write the same Dirac equation in a spherical polar coordinate system, then you are in problem. Because now you cannot prove the relativistic covariance here. That's because the natural coordinate chart that's induced in a spherical polar coordinate system is not holonomic. Whereas here, it's a holonomic system. It means that it's inertial. If you take this natural coordinate system in this coordinate chart, in the Cartesian coordinate chart, all the connection coefficients vanish. We are in a flat space-time. Curvature vanishes. That's the definition of Minkowski flat spacetime. However, we haven't said anything about the vanishing of the connection coefficients. And in a Cartesian coordinate chart, the connection coefficients are all vanishing, identically vanishing. It's an inertial coordinate system. But on the other hand, if you go to a rotating frame, rotating coordinate system, like a spherical polar coordinate system, well, the connection coefficients are not zero. I have given you some exercises to show that. And the connection coefficients are non-vanishing, but the corresponding curvature vanish because we are in flat spacetime. So you want to do something to be able to write down the Dirac equation in a non-inertial coordinate system. This is not possible to do it in this form. This is specific to a Cartesian holonomic coordinate system. So in order to be able to write everything in a non-holonomic coordinate system, you have to introduce the connection even in flat spacetime. Now the way to introduce a spin connection one form is to contract the Levi-Civita connection one forms that I have introduced before with the generators of the Lorentz transformations in the spin space. So I consider 1/2 the Levi-Civita connection one forms and contract it with sigma AB. Remember that sigma AB is nothing but 1/4 of the commutator of two gammas. Now I have discussed the Clifford algebra for you, and then I have shown you that this Clifford algebra basis contains the generators of this spin group associated with that Clifford algebra. Now in the Clifford 1-3 that we are working with, the generators of spin 1-3 are sigma AB. And by the way, this spin 1-3 is the double cover of the Lorentz, the group of Lorentz transformation, which is nothing but SO13. Spin 1-3 is 1-2 homomorphism. It's a double cover of the Lorentz group. Now, you should be familiar with this homomorphism because I think in classical mechanics, you also see that, for instance, the SU2 group, which is spin 3, is the double cover of the rotation group SO3. And when you have spin 1/2 considered, which is the case here, you have to use not the Lorentz algebra, Lie algebra, but it's spin cover with a 2-to-1 homomorphism. So I'm going to call this the spin connection one form. And given the local Lorentz transformation law for the spinor field, and the local Lorentz transformation for the connection one forms that I have tried, there is this inhomogeneous term, remember, you can show that the connection, spin connection one form transforms as a connection under the Lorentz transformation matrix S. And here is the crucial inhomogeneous term. And then we define something that we call a Lorentz covariant exterior derivative of a Lorentz Dirac spinor, which is nothing but the exterior derivative plus omega psi. Now, you can understand that this is it has a proper Lorentz transformation property. You can see it in the following way. If you make a Lorentz transformation, then psi goes to S psi. However, if it's a local Lorentz transformation, this exterior derivative differentiate both S, the Lorentz transformation matrix, and psi. Well, S times d psi is a term that you want. On the other hand, what are you going to do with this ds, ds psi term? Now, that's there. When you look at this transformation law, you have omega going as S omega S inverse plus S ds inverse, and psi going as S psi. Now, the first term is okay. S psi S inverse times S psi is just S acting on omega psi. That's just a proper Lorentz transformation. What about this term here? The second term gives you S ds inverse S times psi. But on the other hand, it's easy to show that for if you are familiar with the matrix algebra, S ds inverse S is just minus ds. So it is minus ds times omega psi, and there is a ds times psi term coming from this exterior derivative, and they cancel out each other, and then you have a proper Lorentz transformation, local Lorentz transformation of this exterior covariant derivative of a spinor. What we are going to do is to use this Dirac equation in a frame-independent coordinate-free notation. Now, this way of writing the Dirac equation doesn't depend on the coordinates. The coordinates can be Cartesian coordinates, it can be spherical polar coordinates, or any other coordinate system can be used for this. It's frame independent. I'm not going to show you the choice of a gamma matrix realization. It's independent of that either. I have used this contraction here. I have introduced a 4x4 gamma matrix valued one form, gamma ABA, and I have used freely the Hodge map. Because everything, the Dirac operator depends on the metric. If you come back to this simple picture here, you have gamma mu, del mu. But this means that we have one contravariant index, one covariant index that's contracted. It means that we are using a metric for the contraction. The signature makes sense. And also, if you are not in a Cartesian coordinate chart, you need the metric, space-time metric, to make this contraction. So that shows itself in this coordinate-independent, frame-independent coordinate-free notation by the introduction of a Hodge star. What it means is that we take gamma wedged into the Hodge star of gamma. It means that this is the inner product of these two matrices. It's a four form. You take the star to make it into a zero form. So we have a zero form on the other side. So that's the frame-independent coordinate-free notation for the Dirac operator. This is the Dirac equation. Now the Dirac equation is the relativistic wave equation of the electron. That was Dirac's first interpretation. Now, having obtained the Dirac equation as a first order linear differential wave equation satisfied by the wave function of an electron. Now the wave function of an electron, remember that it's not Schrödinger's theory. The wave function of the electron now is a four-component spinor, complex valued. Now, I think I'm going to go into the physical interpretation of this Dirac equation. It is a four-component complex spinor, and I have written the gamma matrices as in block diagonal form in terms of 2x2 blocks. So it is rather natural to decompose the four-component Dirac spinor into two-component spinors, upper two components, lower two components. The free Dirac equation satisfied by psi then decomposes into two coupled equations satisfied by the upper two components, pi, and the lower two components, dotted spinor, chi dot. I'm going to explain what this dot undotted and the dotted spinors mean. Use the Dirac matrices introduced by Dirac himself. Remember that. Let psi be written as in terms of two component spinors, psi, phi, and chi dot. Write the decomposed Dirac equation into two spinor equations. So the first line, in fact, becomes 1 over C d phi by dt plus sigma dot grad of chi dot, and then this is minus mc over h bar phi. And then the second equation is an equation for chi dot, which involves this operator acting on phi, and it is plus imc h bar chi. This difference between the minus sign and the plus sign here is important. Now, in order to give a physical interpretation for the Dirac equation, let us take this form of the Dirac equation, decomposed into two spinor equations, and let us look at for the rest frame solutions. Rest frame, x doesn't change. The spinors phi and chi dot are functions of the time only. So you get rid of these terms here. The gradient on chi dot doesn't contribute in the rest frame. The gradient of phi doesn't contribute in the rest frame. And then you see that you have the derivative, time derivative of phi is proportional to minus mc square h bar phi with a minus sign. On the other hand, the time derivative, time rate of change of chi dot is plus I mc square h bar chi dot. So you get a simple solution for phi and a simple solution for chi in the rest frame. So if you take the initial value, phi at time z equals zero, the time evolution of this two spinor in the rest frame is a positive energy solution. Mc square is the rest mass of this object. And this minus sign shows that this is a positive energy solution. Now, the solution for chi has the opposite sign on the right-hand side, so it's a negative energy solution. So you see that in the rest frame, the Dirac equation admits a two spinor, upper two spinors are positive energy, the lower spinors are correspond to negative energy. Now, it is very difficult to interpret these positive energy and negative energy solutions at first sight. And also, you should be aware that this is not really unexpected. Why? Because if you go back to our starting point, the argument of Dirac started that instead of e square equals c square t square plus m square c to the fourth square of the energy, relativistic energy expression, I'm going to consider the square root of both sides. Well, why should you stick with the positive energy sign, positive square root? You could as well do everything with the negative energy square root. So in fact, the square of the relativistic energy expression, when you take the square root, has two solutions, the positive square root and the negative square root. So this is the problem they are meeting here with positive energy solutions and negative energy solutions is a reflection of that one. So these rest frame solutions of the Dirac equation contain both the positive energy solutions, which are described by the upper two components of the Dirac spinor, and negative energy solutions, which are described by the lower two components. Now, Dirac had taught quite a lot. He spent something like 4 years trying to figure that out, what's happening. He at first, for instance, considered that, so perhaps the positive energy solutions with a positive charge, with a negative electric charge correspond to electrons, while negative energy solutions, well, they should correspond to a positive electric charge. Well, maybe they are protons, but then people pointed out that in the Dirac equation, both the positive energy solutions with negative charge and the negative energy solutions with positive charge should have exactly the same mass. In that case, the proton interpretation is no longer valid. So according to Dirac, he came out with the whole idea. He argued that these negative energy solutions to correspond to fully occupied whole states. According to Dirac, the vacuum state for the Dirac equation consists of all quantum states of the electron in the positive sector of the energy spectrum being empty, and all negative energy levels that are occupied by the electrons and they are full. And it is the zero energy vacuum state that separates these two sectors. So that's the vacuum state of the solutions for the Dirac equation. In the rest frame, all the negative energy solutions, energy levels are occupied by the electrons, and all the positive energy states, the energy levels of the electrons remain empty. Now, if you want to excite one single positive energy electron to a higher energy level, you take one electron from this electron C with negative energy, and you give energy to the system and raise it to the positive energy level. However, this leaves one whole state, negative energy state, empty. And you know that a positive energy electron moves as if it's a massive object. On the other hand, if you take a sea of electrons with negative energy, and if you just create a hole by taking out an electron, that hole proceeds, moves as if it is a positively charged electron. So this is in fact a very simple description of the process of electron hole pair creation out of the vacuum state. Today, this interpretation survives in non-relativistic many-body theory. When you do semiconductor physics, you talk about the electrons, you talk about the holes, and then of course you can have electron hole pair creation process out of the vacuum. And the converse is also true. If you have an electron and a hole, they can annihilate each other, and then you get a vacuum state. This interpretation survives in the many body theory. Well, in quantum field theory, we have another interpretation that I'm going to come. Now, the presence of negative energy solutions of the Dirac equation can be also understood in the following way. Let us go back to the free Dirac equation above as a coupled system of two component spin-off equations. Let us take the Hermitian adjoint of both of the equations. So, and after that, multiply them from the right by I sigma U2, and use the fact that I sigma 2 sigma I sigma 2 is just the complex conjugate of the Pauli matrices, complex conjugation here. This means that sigma 1 and sigma 3 doesn't change sign, whereas sigma 2 changes sign because sigma 2 is pure imaginary skew symmetric. Under complex conjugation, it changes sign. Sigma 1 or sigma 3 are real symmetric. So under complex conjugation, they do not change sign. So this is a charge conjugation operation. And then we define what's called the dotted two spinors in the following way. I take the complex conjugate of the two component spinor and I multiply it by I sigma 2. So that's the definition of phi dot. If you come to think about that, if phi has components phi 1 and phi 2, phi dot has components phi 2 dot minus phi 1 dot. Okay, so they are related. Dotted and undotted spinors are not something independent, but they transform under different representations of the Lorentz group. And then the conjugate of phi is phi dot, and chi dot is similarly the conjugate of a two-component spinor, chi 1, chi 2, with the same prescription. And then the whole Dirac equation can be conjugated in this way. You take the complex conjugate of both sides, and then you multiply from the right by I sigma 2, and then you obtain a system that is satisfied by phi dot and chi. Remember that the original Dirac equation has been written for the two component spinors phi and chi dot. And by taking the complex conjugation according to this prescription, it's not an independent field equation, it's the Dirac equation, charge conjugated, which is an equation, system of equations for phi dot and chi. Now this is recognized as the Dirac equation satisfied by the charge conjugate matrix. So I take psi bar, and I write it as transpose, because if I don't take transpose, psi bar is a row matrix. Psi is a column matrix, psi bar is a row matrix. I take the transpose and write it as chi phi dot. So I replace the Dirac equation with complex conjugation. They both satisfy the corresponding Dirac equations. And you see that the charge conjugation, the psi bar, can be written in the form of psi dagger. This is our Hermitian conjugation. So it takes the column vector into a row vector, takes the transpose and complex conjugates all the complex components. And then you multiply this from the right by the charge conjugation matrix in the gamma matrix realization. We read this just I gamma zero gamma two. It satisfies, it's a complex, C square is minus identity, and it is skew symmetric. And this is how you define the charge conjugated matrix. Now you see that in the rest frame, if you look at the solutions, now in this case, phi dot, I think I have a sign mistake here. Yeah, I have a sign mistake. I'm going to correct these. I think I have forgotten to change the sign here. Now, in this case, if you look at the charge conjugated matrix, it is chi that becomes a positive energy solution, and phi dot becomes a negative energy solution. So you see that if you go to the original Dirac operator, it's this one, you see that phi corresponds to a positive energy solution, whereas chi also corresponds to a positive energy solution, but in the Dirac equation, we have chi dot, which carries the negative energy state. Now I have defined you the charge conjugated spinor, which replaces phi with chi dot, and chi dot with phi dot. Then chi has positive energy, and phi dot has negative energy solutions. So the Dirac spinor carries both the positive energy and the negative energy solutions, but you can regard the positive energy solutions of the Dirac equation as an electron field, describing an electron field. And then what do you do with the negative energy state? Instead of considering chi dot for physical interpretation, go to the conjugate equation for psi bar, and in which case, the conjugate Dirac equation have positive energy solutions chi. So phi corresponds to positive energy states, and chi dot corresponds to negative energy states, but you can interact with the negative energy states as positive energy states of the anti-electron, the positron. So Dirac equation describes electrons and positrons within the same spinor field. And you cannot decouple these things in this representation of the gamma realization of the gamma matrices. Let me come back here. Now this interpretation of Dirac is far-reaching consequences. In fact, you can regard this as one of the greatest discoveries of the 20th century, because in that sense, what Dirac had shown that by linearizing the Klein-Gordon wave equation by taking the square root is that he obtained a consistent relativistic wave equation for a negatively charged electron field. The Dirac equation being written in terms of spinors, it's a description of the spin 1/2 fields. It naturally explains the spin of the electron being h bar over 2. It's a spin 1/2 representation of the Lorentz group. It has a mass, and then the negative energy solutions necessarily exist. And then by taking the conjugation under the charge conjugation operation, you can interpret these negative energy states as the positive energy solutions for an anti-electron, which has the same mass as the electron, but it has the opposite electric charge. And then you can also predict, according to Dirac's interpretation of the vacuum state of the Dirac equation, that a pair annihilation process or a pair creation process are possible. You can let a photon decompose, annihilate, pair create an electron and a positron, or you can take an electron and a positron and they can annihilate both and they go to a photon state. So this is the beginning for what's called the quantum electrodynamics. And the first steps in quantum electrodynamics naturally was achieved by Dirac himself in the 1930s, because the first paper after the relativistic wave equation paper written by Dirac was in 1930s or 1932 perhaps, was the first paper of quantum electrodynamics. It's based on this pair creation and pair annihilation processes. So first of all, the positrons had been observed in 1932. Maybe I should put a remark here because this is a very interesting example in the history of science. The positrons are not found under natural consequences because of the pair creation processes. In the nature, we have dominantly electrons all around. All the atoms are made up of electrons and the nucleons. The positrons exist under very unusual circumstances. You can create a positron, but then if a positron meets an electron, it immediately annihilates. and then there is nothing but a radiation that's left behind. So it is very difficult to observe positrons. They don't exist under natural consequences, natural conditions. They exist in cosmic rays, and that's where they were first discovered in 1932 in California by Anderson. Immediately after Dirac's interpretation of an negative energy solution of the Dirac equation as an anti-electron. And then immediately after this discovery of positrons in the cosmic rays, people at the Cavendish Laboratory have observed that, well, actually when they were looking at their cloud chamber pictures, they were observing positrons. And this is an important thing because in the cloud chamber pictures, when you are looking at the products of the particles coming out of a beta decay, well, electrons, if you pass them through a magnetic field, they will spiral in a certain sense. They are left-handed, and if you have a magnetic field going up, they will spiral to the right. And then most of the spirals that they observe in their cloud chamber pictures were spiraling to the right. Well, that's natural. And then once in a while, very few examples have the same spiral, but with an opposite helicity. And they were not able to explain this occurrence of such results. And statistically, they were throwing these unusual cases, exceptional cases, they were just neglecting them. And then once they realized that there is a particle that's called a positron that would spiral to the left rather than to the right in a magnetic field, they realized that in their data they were observing positrons. But the, of course, the credit for discovery, observational discovery of positrons go to Anderson in 1932. But you should also remember that in the lab, at the Cavendish lab, when they were investigating the decay products for the beta decay, people were all the time, they were observing positron tracks, which they wouldn't be able to interpret without the Dirac equation. So in a sense, the theory is essential in the observation of antiparticles, and it is telling something more about the fermions in nature, because it's not only telling that the electron has an anti-electron associated with it, it's also telling us all the fermions have their antiparticles associated with it. So for a proton, we have an antiproton. For a neutrino, we have an antineutrino. We have for a neutron, we have an antineutron. And this is also something that I want to emphasize. Now, it is more than changing the sign of the electric charge of the particle. Going from the particle state to an antiparticle state is something more than changing the sign of the electric charge that the particle may carry. For the electron, the picture is simple. The electron is negatively charged. So if you want to consider the positron states, you just change the sign of the electric charge to plus E, and that will describe the positron, the same as the electron, with a plus E charge with a spin H bar over two. And similarly for the proton, antiproton is negative, carries a charge negative E, no problem. But what about the neutron? Neutron is electrically neutral, the name suggests that. But when you take its charge conjugate, antineutrino is an independent state. It's not neutron, it's an antineutron, it's an observed particle. And then all the fermions have their antiparticles independent of themselves. If they are electrically charged, the antiparticles carry the opposite sign of the electric charge. If they are neutral, their antiparticles are independent neutral particles electrically. In the nature, all the particles and antiparticles come in pairs, except one case, and that case is the photon. Photon doesn't have any charge-conjugated pair. In a sense, you can call a photon to be self-charge-conjugate, all the particles, all the fermions and all the bosons in nature come in pairs, electron positron pairs. So in that sense, the discovery of antiparticles in the Dirac equation is a very important and crucial discovery. And one remaining essential question concerns our nature is that why do we have dominantly particles in our nature, in our world? What happened to the antiparticles? Because Dirac equation is an essential equation that describes QED or our essential grand unified theories. And as we have seen that if you have positive energy solutions that are identified with the electrons, well, unavoidably, you have also antiparticle, anti-electron solutions as well. But on the other hand, you look at the nature all around you and you don't see protons under positrons. You always see electrons. Why is that? That's one of the main mysteries of the universe that has to be explained. The Dirac equation points out the problem. Probably the answer to that question also lies with the study of the Dirac equation as well. Well, okay. Up to this point, I think we have seen the Dirac equation. We have looked at its rest energy solutions to show that the and negative energy solutions are unavoidable. And we have introduced this charge conjugation operator acting on a Dirac spinor to interpret the negative energy solutions of the Dirac equation as the positive energy anti-electron solutions of the conjugate Dirac equation. Okay. Now I want to come to the two-component spinors. Remember that in this discussion, the decomposition of the Dirac 4 spinor into two-component spinors, upper components and the lower components, were essential. And we have the dotted spinors and the undotted spinors. So what are they? Now these two-component spinors are called Weyl spinors, right? So I have a two-component complex spinor, upper component phi 1, lower component phi 2. And I can write a relativistic massless Weyl equation that it can satisfy. Here, introduce a relativistic four, a 2x2 relativistically covariant matrices. If I take the 2x2 identity matrix and three Pauli matrices, I can combine them into a contravariant object under Lorentz transformations that I call sigma A. I could have called it sigma mu, doesn't matter. And then this is my, well, it's not the Dirac operator, but it's a 2x2 matrix operator acting on a two-component spinor. This is the Weyl equation. This is an essential equation. And remember that this sigma A in an algebraic sense is nothing but a complex quaternion, I times a quaternion basis. I could have written this Weyl equation without introducing these matrices, matrix independent way, using quaternions, complex quaternions and their behavior under quaternion conjugation. Quaternion conjugation changes the sign of, well, it's I times this. So it is changes the sign of the zeroth component, doesn't change the sign of the second component, just complex conjugates it. So quaternion conjugation of these four vector, let me say, make the 2x2 matrix valued four vector is multiplying, taking this complex conjugate and then multiplying from both sides by I sigma 2, I sigma 2. And then that's the quaternion conjugation. So under the complex conjugation of the Weyl equation above, and if I hit it with I sigma 2 from the left, I obtain the conjugate Weyl equation satisfied by the dotted spinor. So an undotted spinor, phi 1, phi 2, satisfy the Weyl equation. And then the undotted, the dotted spinor, I sigma 2 phi star, satisfies the conjugate Weyl equation. And remember that this contravariant vector, four vector, is conjugated, quaternion conjugated. So if I give you a Weyl equation satisfying massless Weyl equation, there is a conjugate dotted Weyl spinor that satisfies the conjugate Weyl equation. And phi is phi 1, phi 2, and explicitly phi dot is phi 2 star minus phi 1 star. Now, Andre, if I introduce a unit quaternion that's given by Q's, a quadruplet, Q0, Q1, Q2, where minus Q0 square plus Q1 square plus Q2 square, Q3 square is 1. Then I can write a Royer's transformation matrix in terms of these sigma I over I. These are quaternion bases. And this these numbers. This is an SL2C transformation. And under a local Lorentz transformation, phi transformed with this SL2C matrix. I think I'm going to skip the interrelation between SO13 orthogonal matrices and SL2C Lorentz matrices. It's something like the, it's almost the same relation between the rotation matrices that describe SO3 rotations and the SU2 matrices that also describe rotations, but there's a 2-to-1 homomorphism. So you can establish the same kind of 2-to-1 homomorphism between the local orthogonal local Lorentz transformation group, SO13, and SL2C, special linear 2-by-2 complex matrices. They carry the representation of the Lorentz group as well. However, it's a double cover of the local Lorentz group, or the orthogonal group. And then these Q numbers are related to Lorentz transformation factors. Now, if under a local Lorentz transformation, a spinor transforms as Q phi, it's a 1-to-0 representation of SL2. It's a positive chirality spinor. On the other hand, you see that phi dot with transform with Q star phi dot, it's the conjugate transformation representation 0-1-2 of SL2C. It's a negative chirality spinor. So a Dirac spinor is decomposed into two component spinor. One of them is in the positive chirality representation of SL2C. The bottom two components transform under a negative chirality spinor under SL2C. Now the chirality, the Dirac spinor is a direct sum of these two representations of SL2C. So you have to remember this. I'm not going to go into any further into this direction. But then I want to emphasize at this point that the chirality of a spinor and a helicity of a spinor are not identical concepts. They are different. What is helicity? Now the helicity is defined as the projection of the spin operator along the direction of the momentum operator. Now for our case, we have a spin h bar over 2 particle. The spin operator is h bar over 2 sigma. And then if you take the projection onto P, divide by the magnitude of P, this is the projection of the spin operator into the direction of P. So if the eigenvalue is positive, this is a positive helicity, right-handed state. If the eigenvalue is minus h bar over 2, this is a left-handed negative helicity state. Now we can call positive helicities right-handed, negative helicities left-handed. That's purely a convention. Now let us construct plane wave solutions of the Weyl equation, and also let us look at the plane wave solutions of the conjugate Weyl equation. And for simplicity, let us take this wave to propagate along the z-axis in Cartesian coordinates. Let me work in Cartesian coordinates. In the Cartesian coordinates, if the particle is moving along the z-axis, then the helicity operator will be h bar over 2, the magnitude of pz, projected onto sigma 3. Now, at this stage, it is introduced, it's convenient to introduce complex null coordinates, z minus ct, z plus ct. These describe waves propagating along plus c. These describe waves propagating along minus c. And then we have two complex coordinates, z and z bar, zeta and zeta bar, x plus iy and x minus iy. This square root 2 is not important. Now, if you look at the positive helicity eigenspinors, phi 1 0 is a positive helicity eigenspinor with pz positive. 0 phi 2 is a positive helicity eigenspinor that moves in the negative z direction. Now, there is a negative helicity eigenspinor, phi 2, 0 phi 2, and a phi 1 0 with pz 0. So positive helicity eigenspinors and negative helicity eigenspinors are distinguished in this case. And in this setup, the Weyl equation in its most explicit form reads it this way. I have given you this sigma A. for y. So I write this 2x2 matrix operator, the while operator, acting on this two component while spinor. And in terms of null coordinates, they simplify. Remember that this is d by d zeta, this is d by d zeta bar, and this is d by du, this is d by dv. And then you see that I get the while equation satisfied by the while spinor phi to be given by this simple system. And then in general, the general solution for phi 1 is given as by a function of v and zeta bar. This is an anti-holomorphic function. And phi 2 is given by u and zeta. This is an holomorphic function. So phi 2 is an holomorphic function in zeta, and phi 1 is an anti-holomorphic function, which depends only on zeta bar. And then they also describe this is propagating along the positive z direction, this is propagating along the negative z direction. Therefore, the positive energy solutions are left-handed. You can check that. While the negative energy solutions of the while equations are right-handed. So if you take a while equation, its positive energy solutions are left-handed. And if you take a while equation, conjugate while equation, its positive energy solutions are right-handed. So I have the same thing applied to the conjugate while equation. Physical meaning of the solutions of the while equation given above are the following. The two-component complex spinor phi that satisfies the while equation describes a massless left-handed neutrino. On the other hand, the complex two-component dotted spinor chi dot satisfies the conjugate while equation, and it describes a massless right-handed anti-neutrino. If phi is interpreted as a neutrino field, then chi dot or phi dot or chi dot should be described as a massless right-handed neutrino. Now, for massless particles, which is what I'm considering here, the while equation doesn't have a mass, it's a massless equation. The massless particles, the helicity of such particles is relativistically in the covariant concept. The helicity of a massless particle is assigned in such a way that it coincides with the chirality of the massless irreducible representation of the Lorentz group. I have written the solution of the positive energy solution of the while equation to describe a massless left-handed neutrino, because that's the physical interpretation. I adjusted all the conventions to give me that left-handed, right-handed. I could have adjusted my conventions in an opposite way. What is left and what is right is purely convention at this case. So I'm making all my assumptions in a consistent way so that my massless particle has an helicity which coincides with the chirality. Helicity corresponds to the motion of that particle, massless particle, whereas chirality depends on the irreducible representation of the Lorentz group that you choose. Now, we have chosen the representations in a consistent way. The spinor field transforms as a positive chirality spinor field, two spinor field under the Lorentz transformations. It is the 1.5 0 irreducible representation. And if you look at the solutions of the while equation satisfied by that positive chirality spinor, you will see that the helicity of the particle, positive energy solutions, coincide with the chirality. Now, on the other hand, for massless particle, helicity is not a relativistically covariant concept because the momentum of a particle depends on the observer. If you are in the rest frame of the particle, the momentum of the particle is zero. If you look at the particle in the rest frame, in the lab frame, if the particle is moving up with you, it's a positive momentum, but you may run together with the particle, and then you may pass, you can run faster than the particle, in which case it will go negative helicity. So you can change the helicity part of the particle depending on the state of motion of a observer state. In the rest frame, the helicity is zero. In one frame, you can have a positive helicity, but in another Lorentz frame, it may appear as a negative helicity. For massive states, the helicity concept is not relativistically covariant. However, the chirality concept is definite. whether the neutrinos are massive or not, they can have definite chirality, but their helicity states are different. So you have to distinguish between the chirality and the helicity. And I don't know what to say in Turkish, handedness. Handedness doesn't really cover both cases, right? When you talk about a left-handed particle, do you mean the helicity state or do you mean the chirality state? For massless particles, no problem. But for massive particles, there is certainly a problem. When you talk about left-handed particles, probably for neutrinos, you talk about the chirality. And then don't mix it up with the helicity state, because the helicity of a massive neutrino might be positive, might be negative, depending on the state of the Lorentz observer. So that's important. So an electron is assigned, if the electron has positive chirality, then the positron should be necessarily of negative chirality. On the other hand, they both may have positive helicity or negative helicity, right? It is irrespective of their chirality. A neutrino is essentially, it has a left-handed, left chirality, left chirality. Now coming to neutrinos, they were at first thought to be massless particles. Electron neutrinos were predicted by in December 1932 by Wolfgang Pauli to restore energy momentum and angular momentum conservation during the radioactive beta decay of a neutron into a proton and electron. Suppose that the neutrino is not known. What you observe in a radioactive experiment, radioactive decay, is explained by neutron going into a proton and electron. But if you don't know anything about the neutrino, then you cannot conserve neither the angular momentum in this nuclear reaction or neither the energy in this radioactive decay. And even at that stage in 1932, Niels Bohr and the group at physicist Copenhagen were contemplating about giving up energy momentum conservation in nuclear reactions. That's very drastic assumption. But then Pauli suggested in an apologetic way even, because people at those days cannot suggest the existence of new particles. It was a very unthinkable thing. So Pauli suggested that, well, maybe if there is a neutral particle that we don't observe in the cloud chamber papers, that may carry the missing energy and the missing angular momentum. If that is so, it must be almost massless and it must be left-handed. Well, it must carry spin h bar over 2. It must be electrically neutral. So he described the neutrino field, right? It is electrically neutral. It has spin h bar over 2. And then, it doesn't interact strongly with all the other particles weakly. Well, the electron antineutrinos coming out in the reactor experiment were confirmed in 1966. And the Weyl equation, massless Weyl equation description of the neutrinos were suggested among other people by T.D. Lee and C.N. Young. There are other people, lots of other people during the same year who were thinking of describing the neutrino fields coming out of these radioactive beta decays into using Weyl spinors, Abdus Salam for one, Bandao for one, and probably Feza Gürsey, Asım Barut for some, and lots of people were thinking, but the most basic assumption observation was made by T.D. Lee and C.N. Young. And then what's interesting is that the existence of neutrinos it was studied by another Chinese physicist, Madan Wu, at Columbia University. And he has shown that, this is a very important discovery in physics as well, in 1958, he verified that the neutrinos, or rather electron antineutrinos coming out of beta decay are always right-handed. This is a very important observation in nature, because we always used to think that the left-right symmetry in nature should be preserved. The distinction between the left and the right, we used to think that it is conventional. We have this saying, right? Sağına sarımsak, soluna soğan koyacağız. Well, that's convention, right? If you change hands, then the definition of right hand changes, just a conventional assumption. And we used to think that the distinction between left and right is just pure convention. But 1958 experiment of C.S. Wu, based on the model of TDD and C.N. Young for describing massless neutrinos by the Weyl spinner, changed everything. Because as we have seen, if the neutrino field is described by a Weyl spinner in the 1/2 1/0 representation of the homogeneous Lorentz group, and if it satisfies the massless Weyl equation, then it has a definite chirality and its helicity is also fixed because it's a massless state, then it is either left-handed or right-handed. And then what C.S. Wu had done, proven observation is that the electron antineutrinos that come out in the beta decay are always right-handed. Well, you can look at the inverse beta decay where proton decays into an antineutrino and a positron and a neutrino, in which case in the inverse beta decay, the neutrinos will be left-handed. It's a difficult experiment because that involves a proton, but it decays into an antineutrino and a positron. Both are antiparticles, remember. Neutrino comes out from that inverse beta decay. Well, the beta decay is more direct and mostly observed, but it involves antineutrino. And it has the antineutrinos that come out in the reactor experiment that were observed in 1966. And 2 years later, C.S. Wu had demonstrated that they are always right-handed. So the left and the right-handedness in the nature is, well, it's not conventional, that's to say. If you want to explain to somebody who cannot distinguish between the left and the right, well, it's difficult to teach them soğan sarımsak, but what can you do is, physicist, well, go into the lab and look at the beta decay of a cobalt-60 atom and then observe that antineutrino. That's very difficult. But then you will see that its chirality is right-handed. That is right for you. And the opposite is left. So you can distinguish between the right and the left through the weak interactions, right? So this is a very important experiment as well. Now, in fact, neutrinos have other surprises for us. We know that electron neutrinos are not on their own. There are muon neutrinos, which are almost an exact copy, but then they participate not in electron experiment, but they participate in muon experiments, and they are distinguished as separate particles. So we have a muon neutrino, they were discovered in 1960s to be independent particles. And then we have tau neutrinos. They were discovered in late 1990s. So they are both novel neutrino types, and they are just left-handed, just like neutrino, electron neutrino. They go into similar nuclear weak nuclear reactions. And then it was in 1958 again, it was suggested by Brune Contecorvo by that neutrino type oscillations between electron neutrinos and muon neutrinos may take place, provided they have non-zero masses, however they small that may be. Well, since more than 6 years have passed since then, we now know that all types of neutrinos are left-handed, so they have definite chirality. All the antineutrinos are right-handed, but they are massive because neutrino oscillations had been proven. I think in 2015, Nobel Prize went to discovery of neutrino oscillations in the Snow Lab in Canada and Kamiokande experiments in Japan, right? So if the neutrino oscillations are true, then the neutrinos must have masses, however small that may be. Now we have
Tekin Hocam, Is this a good place to stop or are you about to finish?
Maybe can I take 5 minutes? Because I have to say how to assign mass to a spinor field. That's important. Okay, I will finish this one, 5 minutes.
Okay.
Now,
okay, sure.
Now, we have seen that the neutrinos should be massive. Electron is massive. So how to assign mass to a spinor field? There are one possible way to introduce mass term is the way considered by Dirac. Now I want to write the Dirac equation in two component notation. However, in terms of a different representation of the gamma matrices, it's a different, this is not the same representation that Dirac had used for gamma matrices. This is a different realization, but nevertheless, I can write the Dirac equation, four component Dirac equation, sets decompose it into two component equations satisfied by phi and chi dot in this way. And I can define, I can assign a mass on the right hand side so that the while operator on phi is proportional to chi dot, conjugate while operator on chi dot is proportional to y with the same mass here. So this is the Dirac mass. And in order to assign the Dirac mass, you can convince yourself that you have both positive chirality and negative chirality state must exist. If you have just a positive chirality state, this doesn't make sense because you will have zero on the right hand side and you will have zero on the left hand side here. So you have to have both chirality states present to assign a Dirac mass. Well, okay. But on the other hand, there is an alternative way to introduce a mass term. Take just a positive chirality state and put on the right hand side m phi dot rather than chi dot, put m phi dot, and the conjugate while equation is similarly comes with the same mass. And then you can iterate this while equation satisfied by phi and its conjugate phi dot to obtain the Klein-Gordon equation satisfied by phi. Okay, so you can assign a mass to a single while spinor, either with a positive chirality or with a negative chirality, or you can assign it if you have both positive chirality and negative chirality states and you put it into a Dirac spinor, you can assign a mass, Dirac mass, but you can also assign a mass to a wild spinor that we call the Majorana mass. So there are two types of masses. If you think about a positive chirality neutrino, a negative chirality anti-neutrino, if they are massive, you can assign them a Majorana mass. But on the other hand, if they both exist as components of a four-component spinor, conjugate pairs, you can also assign them a Dirac mass. So you get a mass matrix which involves both the Dirac mass and the Majorana mass, and you can discuss seesaw mechanism, for instance, etc. That's all for later work. I think I am going to stop here. I will take up maybe the Majorana spinors in the next lecture. Okay, if there is questions, this is a good point to stop.
Okay, Tengen Hocam, thank you so much for this nice lecture. Do we have any questions from the audience?
No.
Okay, then I'll stop recording.
Okay.